Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Under the Lights, driven by Chevy. I'm Scott Klatzkin here with interim head coach Dennis Dottin-Carter. And coach, coming off of a two-game winning streak, you go down to Richmond and have to face the number eight team in the country. A solid performance by you guys. You really battled, but in a game that was won because of Delaware forcing the turnovers against Albany, a week later, you gave the ball away just too many times to the Spiders.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, you have to take care of the football in this league, and I mean, around the country, it's the game itself. You have to give yourself the opportunity to score. It's hard enough to score when you have it. It's obviously a lot harder when you don't have it. So we can't give a team like Richmond, you can't give any team more opportunities to score, but a team like Richmond, who does a great job, number one, of keeping the football, they're one of the top teams in the country in time of possession. You know, you have to take the ball away from them, and we didn't do that. So on top of giving the ball away four times, we didn't take the ball away from them at all. And we still found ourselves in a good position. We found ourselves with an opportunity to be in the game and to go up and tie the game, you know. But again, we didn't get the stops we needed. You know, there were a couple drives, the last two drives that they had in the fourth quarter. You know, they were both pretty short drives. The first one was a five-play drive, and you know, big plays were the story once again. And then the last one, you know, the two hookups from La Lutter to Brown, really, you know, sealed the game for them, closed the game out. And even after that, we found ourselves on offense with the ball, with a chance to go score and kick an onside kick and have a chance to tie it up, you know, but then we gave the ball away one last time. So, I mean, certainly, you know, any team that you play, you can't give them the ball. You gotta take advantage when you have it and go score, and you gotta try, you know, take the ball away to give yourself more opportunities. But a team like Richmond, whose offensive firepower is unbelievable and their defense is so really, really good, that's a death mark.
Now, you talk about Laletta and Brown and that really short drive where they had two large hookups, but those are two players that many teams, every team, has trouble stopping, two of the better players in the country. I thought your team battled. You came up with stops in the red zone, held them to three on a first and goal to go situation. You got some three and outs in that game. Your defense battled, but ultimately were Laletta and his combination of receivers just too much?
Yeah, it's, you know, they are tremendous, tremendous players. Laletta and Brown are two of the best, if not the best, at their position. I can't imagine that there are guys out there that are much better than them doing what they do. You know, there's, you know, the other kid in the conference is Brian Shore. I mean, both those guys, you know, it's going to be tough choosing the first team all-conference quarterback is. But I can't say enough about those two guys. But the guys on defense did battle. But at the end of the day, you know, they ended up with 12 or 13 explosive plays, and you can't win a football game and you're giving that up on defense. And they ended up, I think, with 466 total yards. You know, if you just take away that last drive, you know, we're holding them to, you know, around 480, you know, 470, 480. It's just, it's frustrating when you know you have the guys who can do it and you're not getting it done. We've got to do a better job putting ourselves in position as a coaching staff. You know, there are probably some things we could have done to try to take, you know, Brown away. But again, you do that, they're going to beat you with somebody else. You know, 17 had a great day as well. He had a lot of the explosive plays that they made. So it's just, they're a tough, tough team to defend. They make you defend the whole field. They make you defend every single player on the field. But, you know, we feel like we can do it. We got to get it done.
Now, back to the turnovers on offense for Delaware. Two of the better offensive plays of the game somehow ended in fumbles. Jalen Randolph, who went 250 carries without a fumble prior to the Stony Brook game, was a guy that usually is very secure with the football. What you saw looking at those plays, was that just a guy just trying his hardest to get extra yardage and the ball pops out late?
That's exactly what it was. You know, the first one, you know, we're going in and he's fighting for extra yardage, and the kid goes to make a tackle. It looks like his hand just comes across and you know, swipes the ball out. You know, neither fumble is excusable. It's never okay to fumble the football. That kid knows it. He's one of the most reliable human beings on our team, not to mention ball carriers. And, you know, it's really unfortunate that he was the guy that ended up having both fumbles, because, again, all he's doing is working to put us in a better position to win. He's trying to win the game. He's trying to win that rep. He's given everything he's got, and that's all we've ever asked him and everybody to do. And, you know, and the result ends up being that. But, you know, we just got to be better.
Looking at the interceptions that were thrown, one, Joe Walker was hit. Ball kind of floated in the air and was able to get under it. Richmond was able to get under it. The other, he kind of scrambled to the right side, threw across his body, threw into traffic. Is that part of the frustrations this year at the quarterback position? where you know he's got it in him to make it pass like he did to Jamie Jarman, a big play. But then on the other hand, he makes some decisions where you have an interception like that.
I think it's the frustrating thing when coaching football in general, coaching athletics in general. It doesn't matter the level. It doesn't matter the sport. There's always going to be something that a young person does or a professional does. You can look at the NFL and see throws being made across the field late for interceptions. It happens. You know, people make poor decisions. The thing that people, you know, the thing that is hard for, you know, anyone watching the game, coaches included, to understand is the speed that those decisions need to be made. You know, it looks open and it's a split second decision. I'm going to throw it. I've got the arm strength to throw it and get it in there, and bam, like so many times we've seen before, the player steps in front of it and picks it off. You know, Joe's certainly got a lot of confidence in his ability to pass the football. He's got a lot of confidence in his arm strength, you know, deservedly so. But you know, that has to be a play where he just takes off and runs. He's continuing to learn to make better decisions, and he's certainly improved in that area. But like I said, you know, you'll see that same throw being made by quarterbacks in the NFL, top quarterbacks. I've seen Tom Brady make that throw. You know, he's one of the greatest of all time. It's a decision that you can't make. Guys have made it, and it certainly is frustrating.
Want to finish up talking about the Richmond game with special teams, because for the second game in a row, Nasir Adderley broke a big return on a kickoff to set up a scoring drive, an amazing job by the special teams unit in that regard, and also Troy Reeder just popping through and getting on top of a punt to block it. Tell me about those two plays.
Yeah, so I mean, the punt block by Troy was, it's funny because we're in a situation where we're in our safe punt return unit, where we're basically, we have our defense on the field ready for a fake. And I just felt like after we hit them with the fake field goal that they might try to get us back with a fake punt. So we were in the safe, and basically Troy just said, I think he just felt like he can get through. And obviously he did. You know, he just made a great individual play. No one was really supposed to go out there and try to block it. He did. And it was a great play for us, obviously. You know, and then the kick return by Nas, again, you just look at a bunch of guys. You look at 10 other guys on the field communicating, playing together, working together, blocking. You know, we have a saying, block forever. Those guys, they're just trying to block to the whistle, you know. So, and it's certainly Nas did he does a great job with the ball in his hands. He's a dynamic athlete. He's a very, very good kick returner. I think he's an all-conference caliber kick returner. And there's some really good players in this conference doing that same thing that he does. You know, so, I mean, just special teams was really good overall. The kicking game, you know, Frank hits a great field goal as well. And our coverage teams were lights out. You know, we were knocking them down, you know, inside the 20 multiple times. And I can't say enough about Will Stevenson, the great job he does. You know, his numbers aren't as high as, you know, some of the other punters in the country and in the league. But, I mean, he does a tremendous job putting the ball where it needs to be and flipping the field at times. And he's got a cannon. He's got a huge leg when we need him to have it. He just doesn't have that. He doesn't always have the opportunities to punt the ball 60 yards.
And a nice throwing arm, too,
that. That's what we found out on Saturday, absolutely.
Continue to drive, that ended up in a score. We're going to talk about Villanova. We're going to take a quick timeout here on Under Lights. When we come back, final game of the season against the Wildcats. Back in a moment.
Welcome.
How you doing?
Thanks for coming. Today you're going to choose a mobile office to drive to a remote work site.
Okay.
You can choose this Chevy Silverado that offers built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi, or you can choose this Ford F-150 that doesn't offer Wi-Fi. But to make up for it, we added a trailer, a satellite antenna, and Dolores.
Hey, fellas.
Technology's a little behind in here.
Now, the Silverado offers built-in Wi-Fi with a connection that's stronger than your smartphone.
Slick.
So which one do you want?
I'd pick the Chevy.
Silverado. It leaves Ford in the dust.
It just can't beat it.
Little details, truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy, it's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
They are family on and off the field, but these three brothers share a special connection between the hash marks.
I mean, I'm extremely proud to be in Nassib because my four older siblings, they kind of paved the way for me. I mean, I have the two older brothers that are in the NFL, obviously, and I have two sisters that are on their own path and they're crushing it. Kind of the way we started, where we always kind of started out being kind, nice and polite. I feel like that's almost like even better because like no matter how famous my older brothers get, they haven't changed, which is pretty awesome. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's awesome that they're in the NFL. I mean, at least a big shoe for me to fill, but I kind of like the way how we're, if when we succeed, we don't change. That's big.
Just like any other family, the Nassib boys bonded over their common area of interest, football.
Yeah, I love football, since I was a little kid. When my oldest brother was in sixth grade, my dad started a football program at the grade school I went to, and I was like 3 or 4, and I went to every practice. Just because he was a coach, I could just go and watch. Yeah, with my white hair, we have a team picture where I sat in the middle holding the ball. It was awesome, I love that stuff. I love going to practice.
The youngest of the 5 siblings, Carl and John, used each other as their own standard of competition.
I don't know how tough I am, but whatever toughness I do have, I attribute to him, because he beat me up pretty good when I was younger. I mean, we were pretty close in age, and we did everything together, so whenever I got on his nerves, he let me know physically. Looking back on it, it was so much fun. I miss it, it shaped me.
Growing up with John was fun. He and I shared a room for about 7 years. He and I were very competitive. We fought all the time, and I just beat him up all the time. And I like to think I made him a little tougher because of it. You know, he's a good kid and he's funny. He takes all my jokes, but you know, I like John. John and I are the same position, so sometimes I try and help him out. And I saw one of his games last year and he had a strip sack, but you know, he did some things wrong, some good things, so I try to help him out with that too. Again, I think the sky's the limit for John. I saw that he does overthink some things, but I think that once he just plays the game and plays fast, he does some really good stuff.
DSU going fast, quick snap, and a throw is intercepted! What a catch by the long arm John Nassib on the second defensive play of the season. Nassib takes it away.
As the oldest brother, Ryan instilled his high level of work ethic in both of his younger brothers.
I don't know, he kind of showed me, like he showed both of us how hard we have to work. I mean, he was doing it in high school. When he was a junior, senior in high school, I was still in grade school, so I didn't really know the grind. But when he was going to be a junior, he was going to be a junior in high school. He was working out 6 o'clock in the morning by himself with a friend. They would hop fences into the local turf field to work out and stuff like that. I mean, he did whatever he could for me. He helped me out when he can. It was awesome. You know, I'm still appreciative for it.
Yeah, just kind of being the oldest brother, I kind of had to go through things first. So, just some stuff that, I went through, I tried to pass through to him, just my past experiences and stuff like that, just kind of help his transition a little easier. You know, we kind of all help each other because we all kind of see different things. And, it's been a fun process. Football is extremely important just because 3 out of the 5 kids play. It's been great for us to be able to use football as a means to bring everyone together.
I think in our family, football's been just really, it's been a blessing. Had so many opportunities to meet so many good people and learn a lot of lessons through the game. And I'm very thankful for the game of football, if that makes sense.
It's a lot easier to come closer together when you love the same thing.
Welcome back to Under the Lights, driven by Chevy. Scott Klatzkin here with interim head coach Dennis Dottin-Carter. One left on the schedule, and it's always the biggest one of the season, the rivalry game against Villanova. Over the past several seasons, Villanova has found every which way to take it away from the Blue Hens, in whether it was the final game of the season or we played earlier a year ago. But it's time to get that trophy back into Newark. Tell me a little bit about what the Villanova week is like, this rivalry week for the Hens.
I mean, the week is always a buzz. It's always, the guys in the locker room, they know it's a rivalry game. Us as coaches know it's a rivalry game. You don't have to really be here. You don't have to be in the building to know. I, at the University of Maine, knew that Delaware-Villanova was a rivalry game. It's a huge, I think it's one of the better ones out there in the college football game. It's not covered like Michigan and Ohio State, but it certainly is a huge game all week. Every week, and including this week, you see the guys, there's a little bit of different intensity to them. You know, I know we have, you know, we have practice coming up, and I know it's going to be a crisp practice. The guys are going to be focused in, they're going to be locked in. There's certainly some extra incentive to beat these guys, because no one in our locker room has beaten them at all in their career. 4 years here and four losses for everybody in that locker room. And then, you know, for us as a coaching staff, a whole coaching staff, you know, this is our fourth year, and again, we don't have any wins. So, you know, a couple guys on the staff who've played here and been here before, you know, they've got a couple wins, but we're not looking at that. We're looking at getting that trophy back this week.
Villanova can thank Delaware for giving Zach Bednarczyk an extra year of practice, I suppose, getting into his sophomore year. Was not supposed to be the quarterback last year for Villanova. John Robertson got injured in that Delaware game, and Zach Bednarczyk ended up sharing Rookie of the Year award trophy with our very own Thomas Jefferson. Yeah. Bednarczyk, the quarterback, small sample size, but he ended up beating Delaware when he came in a season ago. What does he and that offense do well for the Wildcats?
He's a tremendous athlete, number one, and he's got a great arm. You know, he's improved his accuracy, you know, as time has gone by. Like you said, he got some much needed experience last year. He came in and scored the final touchdown and beat us, you know, so we certainly know how good of a player he is, and he's continued to show it. He had some up and down games last year as the year progressed. He's been a lot more solid this year. He's, I mean, it looks like he leads that offense. Looks like he manages them very, very well. You know, so I know Coach Venuto does a great job up there in scheming things up, and he's done a great job over the years scheming us up. And he takes what we give him, just like most good coordinators do. And then Bednarczyk does a really good job of playing within the offense. So he can be a playmaker. He can make plays. If it starts to break down, he can use his legs. He can run. They can dial up runs to get an extra guy, a ball carrier, an extra blocker. You know, he does a tremendous job. He's a great athlete. He's a very good quarterback, and he still has time to grow.
And defensively for Villanova, always a hard-fought defense, always guys that are going to be bruisers out there. I would think the same this year. They're coming at you.
Yeah, right now they're the best defense that we're going to see. You know, they're, in my opinion, the best defense in the country. I know there's some really good defenses out there. These guys are right there. There aren't very many teams who are going to just be better than this group right here. You know, they're well-coached. Coach Crocker does a great job with them. I mean, all their coaches, they do a tremendous job. They've recruited some really, really talented football players. You know, up front, Tano Passano, he's an NFL-caliber player. I mean, He's a draft pick caliber player with his size and his speed and his athleticism. He is an unbelievable player. At the linebacker level, they have multiple guys in Shockley and Steve who do a great job. Rob Roll is leading the league in picks, and it's all he does is get picks. You know, we certainly will not throw the ball his way, but you know they've got playmakers on every single level. They've got they run around to the football. They play very, very well in their scheme. Their scheme's a little bit different. So you know you gotta make your game plan a little bit different as you go through the week. So, and that's a weekly thing. We'll have a little bit of an advantage because we played another three down team in Richmond. So there'll be a little bit of carryover this week for us. But again, you know the scheme doesn't matter when those guys are out there running around and you're not blocking them. So we certainly need to step up. You know the guys know what's at stake. It's Villanova week. It's Battle of Blue week. It's the 50th all-time meeting. It's Andy Tyler's last game. There's a lot to play for. You know, for Villanova, there's a lot to play for Delaware. It'll be a great game.
It certainly will be. We look forward to it. You mentioned a lot of things about this game. One of them, Andy Talley's final regular season game as the 13th ranked team in the country. They're in position at least to continue on into the playoffs. But you played against Andy Talley. You've coached against Andy Talley, and now as a head coach going up against him, what does it mean to coach against Andy Talley in his final game?
Yeah, I mean, it's his final game at Delaware Stadium. It's my first game against him at Delaware Stadium. I mean, the guy's a legend. He has done a lot for the game of college football. It doesn't matter the level. He has been a figurehead for FCS, 1AA college football. He's been as successful as anybody out there. He's won a national championship. He's won multiple conference championships. His teams have been very good over the years. Graduated guys, put guys in the NFL. I mean, you name it, he's done it. He's been a great mentor to a lot of coaches out there. I mean, you know, when he started, the guy who I played for was a young coach, and I know he spoke highly about him all the time, you know. So the one thing I can certainly remember as a player was Andy Talley's teams always being tough to beat, always being very, very talented. They've always done a great job recruiting, you know, smart, tough, talented football players. It was always tough to play against them. Certainly, we got the best of them a few times, but it was always tough to play against them, and to coach against them, it was even harder. You know, it's a great program. It's going to be in great hands when he leaves. I know Coach will do a great job up there, but Andy Talley, he's a legend. There's not much more to say. He's a great legend, a great human being, and I'll certainly look forward to our pregame talk.
Well, as great as he is, it would still be very nice to spoil his final trip to Delaware Stadium. How important is it for this team, and every week is important, but with the season that Delaware has had, to end on a high note on Saturday, what would that mean to the Blue Hens?
I think you always want to, you know, if you're not, no matter what, you want to end your season on a high note. You want to go into the offseason as a winner. You like that to be the national championship game. Otherwise, you're going to go in as a loser. Unless you win your last game, you know what I mean. But either way, that helps so much. Going into the offseason after 2015 was so much better than going into the offseason after 2013 or 2014 because we won that last game against Elon, and the intensity is there, but there's just a little bit more. You know, there's just a little bit more belief. It just brings the guys together a little bit more. We had a great offseason. Again, the great offseason did not equate into the wins that we wanted, but you know, we were right there. We played a lot of really good teams, and we played a lot of teams close, and you know, other than James Madison, you know, we're right there in every league game that we're playing. You know, it's frustrating, but to go in with a win, not only against a great team but Villanova, would be huge. You know, the Battle of the Blue, like I said, all these reasons that we have to be motivated to win the game, you know. At the end of the day, the huge motivation is going to be to go out as winners.
Well, best of luck to you on Saturday. Win or lose, we can't say enough about what you've done to represent this school, to rally the team, to keep the team together, to win some ball games. You've done it with class, and we appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Best of luck on Saturday as Delaware takes on Villanova for the final game of the year. Your last chance to get to Delaware Stadium and see this squad. Kickoff is at 3:30. Tickets available at bluehens.com. For interim head coach Dennis Dottin-Carter, I'm Scott Klatzkin. Thank you for watching, and as always, go Hens.